7 o'clock, and this is the September 19th meeting of the Conway Selectboard. We're being videoed by Frontier Community Access Television. Is there anybody else who's recording us? No? Okay. First item on the agenda is the minutes for September 6th. Everybody read those?
Yeah, they read it.
You guys like those? Any changes?
I made a couple of corrections to typos in my own update.
Nothing significant.
No.
Okay. One of you will have to make the motion.
I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes of September 6th.
Aye.
Second.
Second. Oh, second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Any more discussion? No.
Good. Passes.
All right. We have three warrants tonight. We have a vendor warrant for $111,235. A payroll warrant for $93,978. And a payroll deduction warrant of $23,693. Make a motion that we accept those warrants. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any meetings attended by select board members since our last meeting?
Yes, last week I attended the quarterly meeting of the Franklin County Regional Transit Authority. The only major discussion we had at that meeting was that they were hoping to use a facility where the Bendix Corporation was in Greenford for the new location for the new housing garage. They got a grant to build a new garage. And, and that got sidelined. It was voted out. So they're in the process of relooking again. The state that oversee the grant went up there with them, looked at the property over and said there was too many problems with it. They wouldn't back it.
Yeah. Okay.
So now they're kind of leaning toward looking at a facility over in Montague, Turner's Falls, Montague area. Other than that, that was it.
Okay.
So I had a couple of them just. Full disclosure, so we all went to the community compact meeting. We had two meetings in the last 2 weeks with Joe, and I thought they were great.
For long-term financial planning.
Long-term financial planning. And at FERCOG, I went to my Selectman 101 meeting. It's sort of an introduction to how to be a good selectman with a bunch of other first-term selectmen. So it was fun to meet them, and mostly we talked about the open meeting law.
Yes.
And on Monday, I went to Conway's Ask a Solar Expert questions. It was the Solarize project that Bryce Herford had up in the library. Okay. So that was good. A lot of people came. There's still a lot of people that have proposals that haven't accepted them yet. So they have until the end of the month. And
great.
Then, this week we had an MCAP meeting, the Municipal Coalition Against the Pipelines, and they're in the process of still figuring out where we go from here and how they can be relevant in a municipal sense, not just opposing things.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that was good.
Great. Okay. Any citizens' concerns? We have any citizens' concerns? Hearing none, we'll move on. Next item is our new business. We have a tax classification hearing at 7:05.
Which is?
I think we're close enough.
Close enough, yeah. Yes. Tax classification hearing will have to be postponed because all of our approvals are not yet back from the state. And so we do not have any definite figures to present to you at the moment. We certainly can discuss the general philosophy of it.
Okay.
The purpose of a classification hearing is to determine whether the town will have a single tax rate applicable to all taxable property, or will split the rate and put in a higher rate on the commercial, industrial, and personal property. That's often done in places like Northampton or Hadley, where a large commercial presence increases the town's cost disproportionately. In other words, they have to have a lot more police, they had other issues. It has never been done in Conway. We have a very, very small, generally speaking, commercial and industrial presence. The hydro plant is the exception to that, but all of the rest of our businesses are generally owner-occupied, and this also would be applied against the land in chapter classification, because that's considered to be the agricultural, and forests are considered to be commercial uses.
So their rate would go up?
Yes, under this particular circumstances. This circumstance. Also, we do not have enough value. Generally speaking, when you get up to 8, 10% or more of your value being in commercial, industrial, and personal property, that's a logical place to start looking at a switch of some of the tax burden. But ours stays down around 4% or less. And so it's not... We would recommend that there not be a split tax rate, but we will present the final figures to you hopefully within a few days.
Okay.
What will happen is that as soon as I have some definite data back from the state, I'll talk to Tom, and we'll see how quickly we can post meetings for both of us at the same time.
Okay.
And it would be a short meeting, but we'd both have to be posted, and it has to go out in the paper at least 48 hours ahead of time.
Mm-hmm.
And that way we can ask for votes as well as the specific considerations and be able to tell you more about it.
Okay.
Is this something that gets settled every year?
This is every year, the classification hearing, yep.
Okay.
Yep. It's not just revaluation years.
Yes.
Yep.
And you have a presentation for us?
Oh, well. Tom has asked me to do a demonstration of the Bob. I'm sorry you can't.
I don't mean that. Okay.
How's that?
Okay. Can you see it?
Yeah.
Too far?
Because you don't get to see it.
Okay. We're zooming in.
Over here.
Of the, excuse me, GIS mapping that we now have available, publicly available online. It is done through the company that does our tax maps, and they host the website which we use, and they also maintain and update our data.
Mm-hmm.
The instructions for how anyone can use this are available on the town website under the assessor's page,
mm-hmm.
and we're also always glad to tell folks how to go about it too. But there's some terrific, useful stuff there. When you first open the site, this is what you see. A map of Conway.
And you're using the site now?
I'm using it right now.
Yeah.
I'm on right now. Using your mouse, you can start to zoom in closer and closer. As you get in, you see more and more information. Let me just close this for the moment. We can look at just plain parcel data, which has to do with the taxing. Tax map parcel identities. We can also add background images. For example, the 2014 state flyover photo visuals. Now that puts that underneath our tax maps. So we get to see structures here. We can see the rivers. We can see a great deal more information about each parcel. There's also, instead of that, there is a topographic map that can be put in. It's very light. I'll show you the other one that shows us the contours throughout town. They were using that a couple of months ago when a company was interested in looking for a new location for a cell phone tower. Find the highest points that would overlook the village effectively, that type of thing. But anyone can use these at any time. You simply choose what to use, what not to use. To search for any property, you can put in its map and number, 410024, I have no idea what that is. It will pull up, as it happens to be, it's the old flag mill. It will pull up the possibilities that are similar to that number. You can click on one or the other. The map will jump to that site and show you the basics of the property record card. Now, you see it's zoomed in quite a good deal. Just move that out of the way. The parcel here, here's the old flag mill up on Shelburne Falls Road. Many of us know it as opposite the old Harris Farm, about just over a mile out.
Mm-hmm.
And when, as the closer you zoom into a parcel, the more information you can see. In this case, you can see the actual dimensions of the parcel. You can see the location of the building. You can see the property line. In this case, this area has silted in the river. The actual property boundary is over here. But this is now banking.
Mm-hmm.
The river has shifted a little bit to the east. Up here in the... Here we go. It's an awkward position. Here you can look at the property record card. And this pulls data from our evaluation system. The information that is not included in this, we do not have owner's names and mailing information, or contact information available through this system.
For privacy's sake.
For privacy's sake. Legally, it is public record, and legally, anyone can call our office and we will provide it.
Get it, yeah.
At, you know, with no argument. But we felt that with the concerns today for privacy, mm-hmm. we did not need to put it right out there.
Sure.
So you can look up a property by, let me get it. There's one way of getting information about a property, various assessment data. Scroll down, you can find the acreage, you can find state use code, a 101 is a single family residence.
Mm-hmm.
You can find street address, you can find all these things. As well as the valuation date, book and page, last time it was sold, sale price. Everything that's, you know, of interest pretty much to anyone. Another nice feature of this is an abutters feature. Let me just pull out a little bit here, back up. There we go. Suppose this individual was requesting a hearing from the Conservation Commission
mm-hmm.
or the Zoning Board, and they needed to know all of the abutters within 300 feet of any part of that property.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we have to certify that list, but you could look. You could look and see. The Conservation Commission can look and see by selecting the parcels within 300 feet, say. And I'm just going to select those. And bingo!
Mm-hmm.
All of those parcels are located within 300 feet of part of any of the subject mm-hmm. parcel. So this is very useful in planning issues, and especially in permitting issues. Now, because we do not have the names and address contact information property owners in there, you can't get the list directly, but that's all right. It still is a useful tool. So to search, you're going to put in either a name and number, or you could put in, 32 Main Street. And what it's done is pick up anything that has 32 and mm-hmm. the letters MAIN in it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's picked up 2332 Main Poland Road,
mm-hmm.
320 Main Poland Road,
mm-hmm.
as well as good old 32 Main Street.
Mm-hmm.
Here we are.
Mm-hmm.
Prominent places in town are labeled with their identifying captions, the town offices. When we get down here to layers, we start seeing more interesting information. The property map, by golly, you take that away and all those property lines go away. But within this category, we have a great deal more. For example, the state flood map. Now, if I zoom out a little bit, sorry, this is an awkward angle for the, to use the mouse, or mouse pad. Give it a second to refresh. There. Those are flood districts, federal flood districts, within the village. And you can do this anywhere in town. We can look at Department of Environmental Protection wetlands. Mm-hmm. Now, they happen to have a very similar overlay to the flood district, of course. By just clicking and unclicking any of these categories, the primary habitat is the category of land that is potentially restricted in use by the Natural Resources Heritage Commission based on protecting endangered species, wildlife, and flora. The South River Historic Map is one that was done by one of the UMass students a year or two ago and is part of the zoning map. Oops.
Could I ask a question?
Yeah.
The last time the town downtown flooded, it flooded the road too, didn't it?
It did.
But it doesn't show that.
This is taken from the state flood control maps. You know, the
which maybe need to be updated.
Maybe. Maybe, but we took them right from the MassGIS site. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Another interesting one we have here is the house age maps. And that's been developed partly, oops, it's a colorful one, partly as part of the 250th project. If I open this category, you can see that each color shown represents a different decade or quarter,
mm-hmm.
century, in which the house that's there now was built.
Mm-hmm.
We can subtract and add any of these that we want. If we want to just look at houses that were built before 1900, mm-hmm. these are the properties mm-hmm. that today have houses built before 1900. This shows over the entire town.
Mm-hmm.
And you can add, subtract, whatever. We can see the development of different sections of town. Let's see, septic condition, take this one off, is a study that was done by the planning board with regard to the center of the village and the potential need for shared septic systems, a wastewater treatment plant. And they coded them, green being properties with new systems that probably would need no assistance, red with properties that either have failed their Title V, and yellow with properties that have a system that's old enough that it is likely to need some sort of assistance in the near future. So this is an ongoing project too, and as they add information to it, we'll add more and more properties to this.
Mm-hmm.
The
And so as you add more data, then the colors will appear automatically?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now under town maps, we have an interesting assortment. We have lot sizes in acres, which is again a series of shaded gradations showing parcels from 1 acre or less up to 50 acres or more. Now as I pull out again, you get a better look at that. So if for some reason we wanted to just look at parcels that we needed to use for a municipal purpose that were say 1 to 5 acres, we could simply look for that single color and they would be located on that map. Current use, shows whether it is used, how the land is used at the moment. Agriculture and livestock are green. Come on. This would be very embarrassing if it doesn't pull up. Oh, sorry, I have to click that one also. There we go. Mm-hmm. Purple is residential, and the blue areas are commercial industrial. Now, this gives us one look at things. We also can look at where are our exempt lands. The lands in dark purple are owned by exempt owners such as the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. The medium purple is the town of Conway. Other exempt properties such as the Audubon Society or the Trustees of Reservations over here. And then the light purple are ones that are still other exempt lands such as the Northampton and South Deerfield watersheds, the grammar school, the Smith College land, this type of thing. So this is our exempt versus taxable property. The rest of the land in town is taxable. Then we can look at another way. They're still there. I'll get rid of septic conditions.
Yeah.
And there. And get rid of it. Okay. These are a little light, but you can see. Land that is permanently restricted has vertical stripes on it for various reasons. The green ones are an agricultural preservation restriction, which means it can never go into housing. The development rights have been given up to the state. Mm-hmm. So this is a method to protect the better farmland in any community. We have APR land up here at the Topman Farm, up in the north end of town, and what was the Crafts Farm. We have the Auntie's Farm. We have a number of pieces. Here's the flats up here on 116, what used to be the Eldridge Farm and is now owned by the Boydens. Those are several examples of that. The turquoise is land that is permanently in conservation restriction. Whether through ownership by the state, if the state bought it under certain laws and articles, then the purpose is for conservation and recreation. It also is land where people, private owners, have put a permanent conservation restriction on that land so that it cannot be developed for housing. The red pieces, which don't really show at this scale, are railroad. We also have wetlands and the Rivers Act, the cemeteries. You know, pretty much any private deed restriction is shown here. They're a bit more visible when you zoom in. Okay. Now, in addition to permanent restrictions, we have temporary restrictions on properties, which are indicated by diagonal lines. A temporary APR, agricultural. It's possible for someone to get one for only 10 years from the state. We have had a couple of those in the past. The chapter classification. If land is taxed at its reduced value as either forest, managed forest land, active agricultural, horticultural, or recreation open space under Chapter 61, 61A, or 61B. Those are temporary programs that have annual or every 10-year renewals. And those are shown here as temporary restrictions on the property. They can be removed, mm-hmm. but at the moment, they have an impact on what can and cannot be done and on the obligations to the owner should there be a change in how the property is used. The private deed restrictions are in blue. Now, In the 70s, a couple of the big developers in town, Timo Realty was one of them, Mount Holyoke Realty in Stony Brook in its different forms. As they were selling off housing lots, they were putting temporary restrictions that there could be only one house on that lot for the next 30 years, say. Most of those have expired now, and we're taking them off as they expire. But someone can still do that. If they want to sell a lot, you can put a restriction like that on it if the buyer is willing to accept it under those circumstances. So these are the types of information that we have here. We can combine two. We can put permanent and temporary both on at the same time. When we pull out, whoops, a little too far. There we go. That gives you an indication of how much land in Conway has a consideration on it, one way or another. A lot of it.
A lot, yeah.
Yeah. So these will be helpful tools in our future planning. One of the things we can see, especially with the state land, okay, look at the dark purples. One of the things that the state is very interested in doing as they purchase more and more land is to protect migratory corridors for our various pieces of our wildlife. The watershed districts are being encouraged all the time by the state to buy more and more of the land that feeds into their reservoir, whether it be in Whately or over here in the southeast part of town. Mm-hmm. They're being encouraged to buy more of the springs that feed in and the land that feeds the springs. So these are areas that are expanding all the time. So all of these characteristics are going to come together and hopefully help us recognize possibilities of different theories of our land use here in town.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Where would be likely to put future housing? Should we consider reopening some of the old roads? Whatever. Mm-hmm. And is some land particularly valuable for future agriculture? A lot of questions we're working on. We'll be able to add more information as we go. And it doesn't take a whole lot. The Board of Health would like to put on a layer showing where percolation sites have succeeded and failed.
Mm-hmm.
When we get to the village here, we see all these little lots in the center of town, most of which were only 50 or 55 feet wide. Well, you get quite a few of those going. There we go. 37 plus a little, 42, 56 feet wide, 50 feet wide. There's not a great deal of location to put a well on your land, mm-hmm. plus a septic that has to be at least 100 feet away, and have them both be 100 feet away from the abutting properties, facilities as well. So we have more tools to work with. And we'll continue to, and we're delighted to add layers.
Is the location of the wells and the septic fields?
It's not on here yet.
Okay.
No, but for several years they've been GPSing them as they do it.
Uh-huh.
And so we simply have to get the big spreadsheet prepared.
Yeah.
And then they'll start showing up, and we'll have a letter, a category over here for Board of Health and things like that. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Lee.
This is
outstanding.
It's good stuff. It's very useful, I think, as well as being informative.
I've played around with the system.
Good. Good.
Looks great.
I hope that people will call and will ask questions, and if there are any particular areas of interest, we'd be glad to consider adding data that would reflect that, too, from any of the boards or committees. Yeah.
Great.
Yeah. So, there we go.
Thank you, Lee.
You're welcome.
I assume that not all towns have maps as rich as this one.
No, some of them are way ahead of us, and I'd say we're about in the middle. Amherst has a particularly fine set of GIS maps and data.
Yeah,
well, they have a whole staff of professionals.
That's right. That's right. But it's interesting because the towns are really cooperative. Mike Onklin down there in Amherst is always saying to any of us who are interested, call me, let me help you with it. Ryan Clary up at the FERCOG is very, very good about helping out as far as providing layers that they have already created or helping us to get started with different things as well. So the towns are most interested in this. And yeah, it can be used by highway departments, it can be used by school departments to plan out bus routes.
And I'd like to see some, it turned into a video game for the
yes.
for the schools as well.
So, there
great.
We are.
Great. Appreciate that. Thank you.
So we'll be in touch with regard to the classification hearing.
Great.
And SIM comment.
Russ.
And SIM comment.
SIM comment. Great. Thank you, Lee.
See you again.
All right.
Good job.
Yep. Thank you.
Thank you.
See you later, guys. All right.
Somebody can move up.
There you go. I was going to say.
Kristen, you're next on the agenda.
That's great. You're a Jedi. Oh, how's that little green dog looking?
Thanks for coming in.
Thank you. Thank you so much. How are you doing?
Hi.
Hi. Nice to meet you. Hi, my dog.
Hi.
So I'll just take 5 minutes of your time. I really just wanted to come and introduce myself. Kristen Gordon, and I'm the new principal of Conway Grammar School. Started July 1st and loved it in the summer. The town, the summer programs. I love it even more now that all of our kids back. You've got a phenomenal educational facility, and I can see the support the town has given to the school, and it's paid off and it shows. So I want to thank you for that very much. We've had some great collaboration already with the fire chief. We had our first drill, and it was the best drill I have ever. Yeah. And chief of police and Trooper Carmichael are helping us with the crisis plan, and school safety is one of my goals this year. Tighten up school safety. You know, unfortunately, in this day and age, we have to do that.
Sure.
And so all of our committees are up and running. We have a school council, and we're also going to put together, I wanted to tell you, a 250th celebration committee. Mm-hmm. I've met with Heidi Flanders about things that the school can do for the celebration, so we're getting on that, some floats and things for the parade.
Right.
Unfortunately, our PTO isn't really... we have two ladies who are wonderful, but they're the only two right now, so we're going to try to get more membership, because I think in the past they've done something at the Festival of the Hills, but this year, because we don't have a lot of people on the PTO, they're thinking about doing something, but unfortunately, but we're going to get that strong, and we'll participate in anything that you want. I've met with Tom already, and we've talked about the video game idea and some other ideas. He's all about the school children, which is great. And again, you have a great community here, looking to move to the area myself. But I really want to just introduce myself and thank you all, and it's a great, great school. It's really a principal paradise, it really is.
Great.
And anytime anyone wants to come and visit and see for yourselves, anytime, any day, let me know and come.
Great.
So really, that's all I wanted to do. Does anyone have any questions? Or
any questions for Kristen?
Well, our kids went there.
Such a great
school. Yeah.
I call it the hidden gem, it really is. You know, I've been in a lot of elementary schools, visiting, touring, looking at things, and this one's really a hidden gem.
Right.
So I'm very lucky.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you. I know you have a long agenda, but like I said, I just want to introduce myself. Thanks again. Thanks.
Thank you.
All right, next item on our agenda is the Festival of the Hills contract. Hello, Sheila. So basically, this is the contract between the Festival of the Hills organization, which is now a private organization, and the town. You have any questions on this?
No, I was just here in case you guys had any questions.
Okay. Did everybody see this? Everybody review that?
It's the town's standard contract that they've used. They've just filled it in. And I gather this will be using up the balance of the previous account over 2 years.
Correct.
So this is part of that.
You guys are standard, I'm not standard, so the only questions I would have, and John and everybody else does, is the insurance coverage seeing you using town property to put your festivities on it. What's up with that?
We have insurance. Kate French acquired us insurance. Mm-hmm. And it has everything that we were told was required.
Have you copied that and sent it down yet?
I would have to ask Kate.
What would be great is if we could get a certificate of insurance.
Okay.
From you, and I can.
I'll get Kate up to send that to you.
Good.
Any other questions? Okay. I'll make a motion that we sign our standard contract with the Festival of the Hills organization. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. We also need to get our accountant's signature on this, so we can all sign it now, but we've got a children tomorrow morning.
Okay.
We can get that. And then it'll be complete.
Okay. So do you need me for anything else?
I'll get your copy.
Give
me some.
Right here?
Yeah.
Change is always hard. Tough change. Or no change at all.
Email
and write out.
All right, great. Thank you. Thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
Thanks for all the work you're doing on the committee, too.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. Good luck.
Thank you.
Have a great one.
You too. Thank you.
All right, next item on the agenda is a letter of appreciation for Erica Goldman for hosting the town website. For years, without many people knowing it, Erica has hosted the town website, and whenever we needed anything, she was right there to help us out. She's and a lot of people know about that.
She started off hosting the email as well.
Yeah. Yes,
so
yeah,
yes,
absolutely.
So this notes both of those, and now that we're shifting over our systems, she's very happy to give up that task. But I thought it would be nice if we.
Great idea. I'll make a motion that we sign this letter of appreciation to Erica. Do I have a second? All in favor?
Aye. Does she have a business in town that she does her own server?
Yes.
Okay, next item is a request from the Open Space Committee for an amended contract with Lori Sanders. Janet, step into the hot seat.
Thank you.
How are we doing?
You're good. Tom, do they have anything?
We have the contract that you had sent before. We might have to delay signing that one if
that's
I'm not
this
mistaken.
This contract.
Yes.
Yeah.
There was some last minute back and forth.
The one that's the expanded one with, obviously not just that lists the things that.
Why don't you explain to us, Janet?
Yes.
What the difference is?
Yes. Okay. So we have now a contract with her just to do an assessment and reporting on the Rose Field,
mm-hmm.
the botanical perimeter and the history, and make some recommendations on recreational use, farming, we're looking at that. As it turns out, she's been very helpful in kind of intermediary and reviewing the river reclamation mm-hmm. project, and I won't go too much about the disposal of the invasives. Mm-hmm. So that is, you know, that's a specified contract for those purposes, and we're meeting with her on Wednesday and going to get an update mm-hmm. on that. But as this work has progressed, it became apparent it would really be helpful to just ask her some other questions about some other properties and other issues mm-hmm. and something beyond the scope of this particular contract. And so what we're going to propose, well, a couple of things. One is an as needed. If any mm-hmm. the town wants to ask the professional ecologist questions, we do that. And then Tom also suggested we put in there, and so you will see a list of other such as requested, but one that the town has brought up several times and I think is very important is an open space of a biological inventory for the other town properties mm-hmm. along with some management plans, suggestions.
Yeah, long-term open space.
Mm-hmm. Long-term and short-term. So that's what we're going to have before you. Now, the little back and forth mm-hmm. is over the issue of liability insurance, which she is a small independent contractor, doesn't have, so she has to, the contract will really be with this other firm, which, by the way, is very well noted, Pete Westover, I don't know if you know. So that would be it. Now, as it's drafted, it's a $5,000 contract over 2 years with an option to renew. But mm-hmm. it's basically $50 an hour, we hope. But then we're going to add on a little bit for handling the extra insurance.
So some other company's going to carry the insurance for her?
Yes. How does
that sit with our town attorney?
This other...
That'll be my
question. Oh, the contract will be with
the other company.
The other company. Okay. And
she'll sublet to them.
Yes.
She's named as the personnel for the project.
For the project. Okay.
Yeah.
And that's actually the way we have it with the current contract that we're doing.
So we're not going to sign it right now. We're going to table it for right now because of this back and forth.
Right.
No,
I think we almost had a final copy and then there were a couple of
because they want to, you know,
right,
start
so
running
by the
their
next,
account.
Next meeting, that'll be.
Yes, we do. We actually do want her to look at that property near the center of town, the one that had been, you know, potentially for open space that you had the big meeting about a few weeks ago. What's the name of that property?
Oh, right, the Sheehan, Will
the
Sheehan's
Sheehan.
Property.
Yeah, because
well,
it is.
Yes.
No, I don't know if that's
you,
still.
You're
I don't
under
know.
The contract with her down there on the Rose
right.
property now.
Mm-hmm. Right.
For a fixed dollar amount that I presume
yes.
is being paid for possibly by a grant or something?
Yes, it's all grant.
Now, future work, if you'd like, you said you would like to have a look at another site, how is that being funded?
It's through the same grant. This is a grant that was identified as a special revenue fund several years ago. And it took us quite a while to track down what it was actually for, and it turns out it was for the open space and recreation plan. Mm-hmm. And so I gave them the good news, and they've come up with this is their plan for moving forward with.
So there's still plenty of money in it.
There is plenty of
yes.
money.
Yes, and I just want you to know, I'm very frugal. I was a fiscal officer, and I'm just very, very frugal. So it's not going to be. You know, just go do it. It's with the Open Space Committee mm-hmm. and consultation with others, you know, specifically what you want to do and work out, you know, what volunteers can do and so forth. So.
Sure.
But you're concerned about this other property
well,
and how to get something
yes,
done quick.
And, right. Yeah. Right. If it's, you know, still potential. I mean, that's the thing mm-hmm. about, you know, special lands and even anything that is in Chapter 61, if the mm-hmm. land comes out, you know, if there's a potential.
Well, I guess my question here
would
is,
have to move quick.
Nothing has been decided about that land up
that's
there,
right. Yeah.
And I just wonder why we're spending grant money to look into this piece of property if we do at the present time we wouldn't even have a use for it yet. If we were to purchase
well,
it, I just think that maybe you're getting the cart a little bit ahead of the horse.
Well,
maybe we
certainly.
Should.
should get closer to saying, yeah, the town is very much interested in that piece of property, or not, because the last few meetings we've had, and all of us have been at them, it's very vague as to which way that's going to move right now.
I think they're trying to find out from their point of view if there would be an open space reason for the town to be interested in that parcel, which is one that we hadn't been considering before so much, except as sort of ancillary to the senior housing or whatever else might go on the property. Well, it would be nice to protect the piece of property as well, but how nice would it be? Is it, would it be an important piece of property to protect? Or,
well, some of it's wetlands, isn't it?
Is it representative, or is it special, that kind of thing? I think that's what they're trying to find out if there's any compelling reason for the town to be interested in it for open space.
That grant money wasn't specifically designed to be spent on town-owned property only?
It's to implement the open, to create and implement the open space plan. So the open space plan has, you know, in it the identification of you know, parcels of potential interest to the town, that sort of thing.
And so this would identify if there was a reason we don't want the property to, I assume.
If there was nothing special on it, it would be good to know it, but so that they can say, well...
But that kind of assessment really shouldn't take very long.
Yeah, sure.
You know, and
yeah,
therefore
I think so.
Wouldn't
yeah.
cost very much.
Mm-hmm. I think that's also an example that she's giving of something that is coming up, but they are interested in looking at other town land. I'm particularly interested in having the Open Space Committee do some of the work on the town forests that are out there, too. Because we've had various attempts at forest management and not really a comprehensive long-term plan. Sheehan parcel is just one example of looking at potential properties.
So this will be worked out by our next meeting.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes. I mean, just I was on vacation last week. You know, just a volunteer.
Yeah.
So a couple of issues related to this, and the Rose property, just from the natural resources. So a couple weeks ago, we had a big workshop on tackling invasive species and how to, and it was very well attended. 25 plus people, very interested. And, you know, real nuts and bolts and how to and why and how you use as little as possible and so forth. Anyway, as a result of one suggestion came back, a request to try an experiment from one of the townspeople of smothering knotweed. I know people have tried this in the past. Laura Sanders actually doesn't think it's going to work. But, I mean, what's the harm in trying and... you know, for the sake of participating. So because it's town property, you, the owner, would have to approve it. We've also been in touch with the Conservation Commission, and yet they want a blah, blah form. You know, we're laying a piece of plastic on a certain size area and trying to, you know, suffocate it.
Mm-hmm.
And
that'll be there like all winter?
There was debate over how long. I mean, I think if we were going to start now, leave it on for a couple of months. But, you know, it depends on when we get your approval and then the CONCOM and how much it's still growing, you know, where we... so it's unclear how long it would stay. You know, the knotweed has roots that go all like this, so... It may be an interesting experiment. So we would... If everybody else still wants to go ahead with this, we would like, you know, your approval in case we do want to pursue
it. You're just going to try it on a small area to
yes.
see if it's going to work.
Yes.
You're not going to try it on all the basic plants on there.
No.
You run out of plastic.
Right.
That's right.
Right.
But why don't we get a final approval when you've gotten the approval from the CONCOM, and I can get that on the actual agenda for the select.
Oh, okay. I mean, they want to make sure you approved it, too. I don't even remember.
I think we're the final approval, aren't we?
I don't see a lot of opposition to the experiment here.
No.
So I would say you're fine to go ahead with the CONCOM and then you know, if you want to come back and just let us know you're going to be doing it, that'd be great.
Okay.
And you can get, we'll do the final.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, it may be because, you know, we're going into winter, so I'm not sure by the time.
Can they call this preliminary
approval?
Absolutely. Okay. I don't see any reason why.
So does Lori have other suggestions for?
Oh, she will have. Yes. She will. Yes. I mean, it came up there that as we walked around the perimeter, you know, and the suggestion was made by, actually, it's Lori's husband, Fred, who's a noted biologist in his own right. His specialty is bees and insects. And when we're looking what's come back since it was mowed in June, I believe, what's come back. And he said that for the sake of keeping down some invasives, but also some weeds that you don't want, that we should mow the field again after the potential turtles have left, which is the end of September, to mow it again, to knock down other seeds.
And I'll have a little bit more of an update on that later on.
I think there's other things that are going to go on there later this fall on the property.
The parking.
No, such as turning it, I believe, over and trying
to... I'll have a whole thing on that.
Bring it back to the agricultural status.
Okay, well, related to that, and we are very concerned about what type of agriculture, mm-hmm. and the strong recommendation is for a low-impact agriculture so that it retains its agricultural status, which we mm-hmm. understand is very important. Yeah. But there are other way other than corn and tilling corn, which, you know, involves the very intensive agriculture mm-hmm. equipment and spraying, which is harmful to the river and the animals.
So that what was done before?
Corn, yeah.
Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Commercial cow corn.
Yeah.
With it right up to the river.
Well, for now, all we've approved is winter rye or winter yes. wheat or yeah. something like that.
Winter rye for this year.
Yeah. yeah.
To be plowed under next spring.
Yeah, to get us up to next spring, then we decide what we're going to do then.
And do you know mm-hmm. when that's going to start, the plowing?
This fall.
Yeah, it'll be after the project's over. I haven't heard back from the farmer yet.
Okay.
We have yet to make an agreement with the farmer.
And
this
can
is
I
all
ask
very
who that
preliminary.
Farmer is?
Well, we're in discussions with Gary Totten.
Okay. For winter rye, and that means he's going to want to grow in the spring and traditional agriculture, which involves tilling everything.
And if he does it...
We haven't had any discussions
well,
with him.
Well, I mean, there's just no other reason he would want to plant winter rye there.
Gary harvests hayland, so...
I know that. I mean, that's...
Too much up in the air at this point, right? It comes in. Mm-hmm.
Okay, just for the future to keep in mind, The floodplain project, Kimberly McPhee has always told us there is money in there for they're going to be planting some native grasses, you know, when they're done, but there was never money for some shrubbery to help retain the banks mm-hmm. and keep others non-natives from coming back in, so. That's going to be something that we will be probably be hearing some specific recommendations from Laura Sanders on, and which had not been budgeted, so mm-hmm. just so okay. you know.
Okay. Thanks for coming in, Janet.
Thank you.
Appreciate
Thank
it.
You.
Look forward to seeing you
again
okay.
soon.
Good night.
Good night.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Next time.
Well, Tom, thank
yeah.
you.
Yeah, soon. Next time, probably.
Oh, yes. Okay.
Okay, next item on our agenda is a request to close the covered bridge for the 250th anniversary music and dance performance, plus two rehearsals.
May I suggest we hear from our treasurer before we go into the other items, for the last item on the agenda.
Jan, come on up.
Hello. So I'm here to share with you that we're having a little bit of cash flow difficulties. And there are several reasons for that. We're typically shortest of money during the months of September and March, just before our tax money comes in. So as you know, we've been signing warrants all through July on fiscal 17 money, of which we haven't received any real estate money yet from. So that's a pretty big number. I actually wrote it down in my letter for you. So we've spent about $1.6 million without having any real estate tax money come in yet. So that's one reason. Another reason is that we still have some Chapter 90 money out. And since I wrote this letter on Thursday, actually today we got some of that in. So I received $72,000. I don't know this yet.
Oh, good.
I received a smaller one. Is it Maine Pole or North Pole? That was smaller. It's Maine, right?
All I knew about was Maine. So.
Okay. So I received $72,000 anyway.
It's Chapter 90.
72 of the.
Did I say 70? Chapter 90 is what I meant to say.
Right. Yeah. No, you said that.
You got 190 outstanding? Something like that?
Yeah. There's 123,000 that hasn't come in yet. So the 72 came in. And then we have a CD that we purchased a number of years ago when we were floating in free cash. And it doesn't mature until December. Mm-hmm. So I actually went to the bank last week to cash in that CD early, thinking that would be the solution to our shortage. And it was going to be $3,000 in penalties. So I said, no, we're going to leave it there till December. Mm-hmm. And I got on the phone with Terry Williams and trying to discuss what we should do at this point. Should I try and borrow money? But it actually makes sense to borrow from our stabilization funds. So we have somewhere in the ballpark of $1.8 million in stabilization funds. And it's pretty easy to borrow from them. So in our investment fund, we have over $400,000 in, so to speak, free cash, so liquid cash that can be taken out. It's not invested in long-term investments. Mm-hmm. So I'm asking for $200,000 to get us through until about mid-October, mid-November. It's always very difficult to put a finger on exactly how fast the money's going to come in and how fast it goes out.
So essentially, we just want to take that $200,000 out of stabilization.
Yes. Return it as quickly as I can because we obviously earn more interest with it in there.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. And Terry was okay with that? Terry Williams?
Yes. So we actually, referred to a IGR, an information guideline release back from 92, which talked about towns being able to borrow from their own funds.
Right.
So there is a specific statement in here that allows you to borrow from a stabilization fund. And they do ask that you return it before the end of the fiscal year. You can go beyond that, but you need special permission from the state.
Right.
In this case, it would be a very short term. Well, and I put it right back in.
Well, after meeting with Lee tonight, she's probably going to be a minimum a couple week delay before we get the information back from the state on the tax rates and stuff like that. And you think that is the adequate enough, or do you need a little more than that? Rather than have to come back just a second time?
So this is the first I had heard that we were going to be delayed. I was expecting Lee to have the hearing tonight and then text.
It may just be 1 week. She may ask you to meet this coming Monday.
So if we're reasonably close, this should do it. If it doesn't do it, I can come back to you in 2 weeks and ask for more. It's not really a big deal. It's just a paperwork shuffle.
Okay.
Yeah, that we could both up it at this point.
You could.
If she needs it. It's available, so I'll take it.
So I could only take what I need I don't need. I could take it in increments.
Worst case situation, what would it be? Instead of 200.
I don't even know how to guess worst case. 400,000 would be worst case.
And we have 400,000.
Yes.
Yeah.
We said 1.8.
We have $1.8 million in stabilization, but some of that's difficult to withdraw out of investment so quickly.
Uh-huh.
So we have quite a bit in our money market accounts.
What's liquid?
I think it was... Right now we have a little too much, and he's going to be investing some more. It was $1.4 million.
Liquid?
Yeah. That's in our money market account. Normally he tries to do a little less than that, but we just sold off some equities and that's where it is right now.
Okay. So you think 200,000 is okay?
I do. I think I can do 200,000. And like I said, if I come short and I ask you to sign this again in 2 weeks, it's
fine. Okay. I'll make a motion that we
approve the request of our treasurer for $200,000 worth of borrowing from the stabilization funds to cover a short-term cash flow shortage. Have a second.
And I specifically noted it's the general stabilization.
The general stabilization fund. Yeah. Okay. Do I have a second?
I did second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And you need our signature.
Yes. Okay. I believe I need all three signatures. Did you get Joyce's? Was she into that?
She was. I'm hoping to have her do it. Oh, she did do it today, yeah.
Okay.
That's right. She will be in tomorrow morning as well.
Okay. So it only gives one line, but I think we need to squeeze three signatures in there.
Okay. We're all in on this.
So and under this ruling, we don't have to have a town meeting or
anything
like that. And we're just taking our own money and then putting it back.
And then I have to file this with the state.
Thank you, Jan.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jan.
Thanks very much.
Okay, now we can go to the request to close the covered bridge for the 250th anniversary music and dance performance plus two rehearsals. Okay, why wouldn't we do that?
I know we've done it before for the 250th. The additional one is two rehearsals. They would happen the 2 weeks and 1 week out.
Okay.
So we just have to make sure that we let people know in advance that
it just be temporary closing.
Yeah.
They're doing rehearsal.
Yes.
Not permanently for the 1 week, the 3 weeks.
No. Yeah. Just for the rehearsal.
All right. I'll make a motion that we approve the request to close the covered bridge for the 250th anniversary music and dance performance plus two rehearsals. Have a second.
Second.
All in favor.
Aye.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is to approve and sign the grant application to Maya for backup cameras. What's that for, Tom?
This is their annual risk management grant program. One of the items that they're particularly interested in people signing up for is for backup cameras, and I know Highway's getting them, and I believe, Bob, did Ron check with you for a fire? So fire's getting some
Highway
too.
Highway vehicles and the fire trucks have them on them, which I think is a wonderful thing.
So there'll be a little screen up that the driver will see?
Yeah.
Cool.
We've only got to get one, three trucks instead of four, but because the new truck we got ordered going, come on automatically. That's got a lot now, so.
So Maya is going to lower our insurance if we do that?
Well, they're going to pay for the cameras.
They're going to pay for the cameras. Okay.
Right.
All right.
I think that the reason that they're able to pay for the cameras is that they expect this to save money in the long term.
What does Maya stand for?
The Massachusetts Interlocal Insurance Association.
Great.
All right, I'll make a motion that we approve the Maya grant application for backup sensors and cameras. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. I had not approved something you're paying for.
All right.
Hey, one way or the other.
That's not Ron's handwriting here.
No, I believe that is our new
handwriting. Beautiful handwriting.
Sign the contract with DEP for the state recycling grant.
This is the annual grant.
Now that grant.
That we get. I did, Bob. I did, Robert. I did ask about the containers, and they've already done the paperwork. They are planning to get 20. They are considering various different ways of handing them out. It is, rightly or wrongly, a suspicion that some of the containers which have been given out for recycling may not actually be being used for recycling purposes. So they're trying to figure out how to better ensure that everything that they give out So they may put, you know, one per customer or have you sign for it and, or something like that. I don't know.
They only got 20 you're going to give out. That's not going to be many people in town going to get them.
Yeah. But I did mention that more would be better in the long run.
Good. Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions on this? And I'll make a motion that we sign the Solid Waste Management District contract for the recycling grant. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Swap shop is what we call the Conway Mall.
I believe there is some technical term for it, yes.
All right, next item is the Sunderland Board of Selectmen has requested a meeting of the four frontier towns. What's that about?
And we are, I think, set to table this after some back and forth. This is a concern about the move from of the Frontier Superintendent's offices and the costs of that move and the logistics of that move. There have been a number of emails flying back and forth since the initial request came from the town administrator of Sunderland, with people, administrators, trying to clarify exactly what the meeting was going to be about and whether or not this is something that had already been covered by the Frontier Regional School Committee, and therefore what is the to what end would the select boards be working on this particular issue. And those questions haven't been resolved at this time, but what has been resolved is that the meeting cannot be any earlier than the first week in August, October. So there's certainly no need to cover that now.
Okay, so that's table.
So these are issues beyond the air quality that we talked about.
Well, they're giving up that building, and there are questions about the costs of the move.
Okay, any items unanticipated 48 hours in advance of the meeting, Tom?
I do not have any.
Okay, your update, Tom?
For committee work, the Conway Moves and Grooves Committee at the Conway Grammar School met to plan running activities for the school year. They will be having weekly running programs, but we're also thinking ahead and planning a spring 5K run like they did last May, and are hoping to do it Sunday, May 21st, 2017, from 9 to 10 a.m. Chief Wimette is aware and approves of this. This is more about the music and dance program for the covered bridge. You can read more about that. It gives specifics of the rehearsals and the performances. And John Heffernan of Parks and Rec is asking for volunteers with equipment to help incorporate some native sand with the ball field base pads to soften them up. He's also asking for volunteers to help design a second shed to store a lawn tractor, drag pitching machines, and other sports equipment. Interested people can contact either John directly, if they know how, or me, about those projects. And departmental...
Go on, John. Much one thing about that. Is he going to try to have that pile of sand removed from the parking lot prior to the festival hills?
I have no idea. I can certainly
down
ask
down there, them. And they dumped it. The reason I asked, I went down to a soccer meeting the other day. They dumped the pile of sand right where the two handicap access spots are. They can get in there on an angle with the cars, but they can't back out if there's two cars in the spots because they've got the pile of sand right there.
All right. That has to be moved.
It concerns me where the Festival Hills come up and handicap parking. It could be a problem there if they don't have the sand moved.
I'll contact them about that.
Thank you.
Also, just as an aside, John Heffernan received an award recently.
Yes, he did. A national award.
A national award.
For excellence in teaching.
Paper, yeah.
Yes. Can we do a little more research on that and maybe recognize him for that more formally?
Sure. It did come up a while back as well. There were he got his second article in the Recorder today.
Okay. Good.
In departmental news, I have submitted a newspaper ad for the Community Development Strategy public hearing on Wednesday, October 5th. That was something I brought up before. We set that date about a month ago. Mm-hmm. To be published twice, once this Wednesday, once next Wednesday. So two notices during these 2 weeks. We'll also send out an email Wednesday to all our contacts. Once we have the hearing, the Community Development Strategy can go to the Housing and Redevelopment Authority for submission to the Department of Housing and Urban Development for their Community Development Block Grant Program. And if I could just say, the CDS goes to the HRA for HUD for their CDBG, it would be a lot easier, but no one would have a clue what I was saying.
Okay. What time is that meeting, Tom?
7 p.m.
In a GP room?
Yeah. Over at the Town Hall, General Purpose Room. And we also have, is what I was mentioning before, we finally have a resolution on using the Rose Field for agriculture with no objections from the Conservation Commission. I have contacted Gary Topman, who is interested in a 3-year contract with the town so he can generate some profit from the effort he's planning to put in this year and next. And we can certainly talk with him about opportunities for low-input agriculture and see what he says about that. I imagine it would be a 3-year contract. The first year is just this year, plowing and seeding for the spring. Then next year he wouldn't be able to plow and plant until after June 16th, which I think is still okay for him. But he would not get the crop the first year that he would think that he would get before. So it's the third year only that he starts to make a profit. Mm-hmm. So that's how I understand his
schedule. I don't know. Do you think he would get any value out of the, what's he going to plant, rye this fall?
That's going to be plowed in.
Mm-hmm. And he's going to plant something, right? This fall, cover crop of some kind?
Rather than just plowing it? Next spring.
After June 16th, yeah. He will be planting a crop for next year, yes.
June 16th of next year?
Yes.
Yeah.
But what's he doing this fall?
He's plowing winter rye.
Winter rye. I just wonder if there's any use for the rye when it comes up in the spring. Whether he will harvest that and make it into straw bales or something like that, maybe.
I think plowing it in is a soil fertility measure. Mm-hmm. So, and it just also helped prepare the texture of the soil, I think. So, so we can talk with him more about the concerns we heard earlier tonight. Regional news, we still have an opening for a representative to the Council of Governments Comprehensive Economic Development Strategy Advisory Committee. I'm a member of that through the Planning Board, and it's a very educational committee, doesn't meet very often, and it approves the annual economic development plan that the COG puts together so that they can get federal Economic Development Administration funding, but there's a whole lot of education about the regional economy, so if anybody's interested in that sort of thing, I can recommend it as not taking too much time and being a place where you can learn a lot. On projects, after a couple of snags with bonding documents and licenses, as of about 5:30 this afternoon, the town hall insulation project has all the details ironed out and is ready to proceed.
So that's what we signed.
Is that going to be affected with the Festival of Hills in a couple weeks?
They're going to start all their major work after that's over. They'll be bringing some materials in and doing some preliminary prep work that's not very intrusive.
Well, I just hope that they can keep it back behind that bar. Rather than store up front and stuff.
Yeah, the storage will be in back of the town hall.
Well, the town doesn't have any land like that.
Well, Ed's
in
with us using
it. Good. I'm glad you checked.
The South River project is proceeding as planned, and field work except for final cleaning should be done on schedule by the end of the month.
Good.
That's all I have.
Great. Thank you, Tom. Any concerns of our selectmen? Hearing none, we'll move on. We got mail. We got to save the date for an economic development summit with the governor, the lieutenant governor, and economic development secretary Ash for October 19th from 1 to 4 at the DCU Center in Worcester. You have copies of this, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Did you guys get one of these in your packet?
I did, yes.
Okay. Because I'm going to go to that.
I believe Secretary Ash is going to be becoming the city manager for Cambridge.
Really?
That is what I heard recently. So I say I believe it. It's my understanding at this point.
Maybe he's cutting his term short. Well, he was the city manager in, was it Chelsea before he went to...
Could very well have been. I know he was
Chelsea.
He came from that.
Yeah, he probably likes that a little better than what he's doing now. We also got an announcement from the Hampshire County Select Boards Association as an invitation to their meeting on September the 29th down at the Blue Bonnet Diner in Northampton.
Is that the Hampshire County?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
If any, you guys got this notice too?
No,
in case you want to attend.
No, that just is one that came. If anybody wants to go, I can make copies of that and give you a.
Yeah, you can email it to us if you want.
Yeah, I didn't.
We got a letter from Mike Haley requesting to use the town hall for his plays for the 250th. Anniversary celebration.
And I've written to him and offered to, you know, walk around the upstairs and have him look at it again, just refresh his memory as to what it looks like now. Maybe he doesn't know what it looks like now. And
okay.
He said that he didn't want to do it at the Conway Grammar School. However, the Conway Grammar School does have a stage, and it's accessible, and I pointed out both of those reasons why it might be a better place.
He's going to be like using multiple locations, I guess.
Yeah.
What I understand. He's asked the Firemen's Association for use of the hall.
Uh-huh.
He's asked the Sportsman's Club, or going to be asking the Sportsman's Club for use of their facility for one night.
Mm.
And I think this is something he's doing several weeks in advance of the bicentennial on the weekends.
I know. Yes, he is planning.
He told me he's got four short term plays he's going to play on.
A lot of things. Yeah, there's. Short vignettes, I guess, mm-hmm. plus a couple of 20 minute plays, and then a full length play for three nights. They haven't been chosen yet.
So he's going to be
work with them, whatever we can do.
Yeah.
Giving us something in detail.
We got this letter from Heath.
Yes.
His Excellency Charlie Baker. I don't think you address a governor as His Excellency.
I think the Honorable is...
The Honorable is as far as standard. You go. Yeah. His Excellency is for bishops and archbishops.
And I think ambassadors, perhaps.
Probably, yeah. Okay. All right, well, this is from
Royalty,
Heath.
Certainly.
Do they want us to support this or what?
Well, it is. They're sending it as an informational piece to towns. We were just copied on it for our information.
And
okay.
So, they don't want us being recognized, or
what's the concern?
Yeah,
it's about broadband and what it's going to cost them per home.
Yeah.
Okay. Are they looking for us to write a letter to the governor?
No, they just wanted to let us know that they have written this letter pointing out that the partial cable towns are going to be receiving more funds per household than the non-cabled towns.
Including Conway.
We're a partial cable town.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
So this is... This is.
We're not making that decision.
It's a response to the action that the legislature took on for our advocacy as well as others that we be given a slice of that $50 million.
Have you guys seen this?
No.
Okay. I don't know.
I'd love to read it.
We
just
sounds like Keith were really hurt when the governor decided not to do the regional Wired West style mm-hmm. plan. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily what Wired West wanted, but he said no regional plan. Each town builds their own standalone broadband system like Leverett did.
Yeah.
Unless you're a town like Leverett, it's you can't build a sustainable broadband system.
Yeah,
right. It really hurts the smaller town.
Right. Okay, from FERCOG, we got this notice on the Municipal Modernization Act. It says an event on October 13th at 7 to 9. They always do a good job on these types of things. I guess this is a request from Franklin County Technical School on their 40th anniversary. They're doing a little bit of a fundraiser.
Yeah.
And they're looking for some support. Do we want to put an ad in their journal?
Hmm. How many kids do we have going there? A few?
Quite a number, I think.
You know, they're our technical school.
They are.
So I think we should give them some sort of support.
Yeah.
Do we have funds for it?
I don't really know where it would come from at this point.
I kind of interpret it as a fundraiser for the recorder more so than the Trenton County Tech School. That's true or not? That's the way I kind of looked at it.
It is an ad from, the recorder is soliciting ads for this special supplement on the tax. Mm-hmm.
Any suggestions?
If you can find the money.
Well, if we can find the money for the quarter, it's where they paid you. It's only $99. I mean,
yeah, $199. We can take it out of the reserve fund.
Well, that would be the finance committee's.
Well, do we have funds in our budget to do this?
I don't know. I'll have to check with Joyce where that would come from.
All right. Figure out where we can take it from. Let's do the $199. Is that good?
Yeah.
Everybody copacetic with that?
If we can find an appropriate source of funds.
Okay. All right, I'll make a motion that we approve a quarter page ad for $199.
second?
Contingent on an appropriate source of funds, please.
Contingent on an appropriate source of funds.
Thank you.
I'll second that.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Yeah, Tom.
Thank you. Yes.
All right, our next meeting is scheduled for Monday, October the 3rd. And I think that is all the business we have tonight. I think we're not going to do an executive session tonight. We'll do that next time around to get up on reason number two. Okay, anything else?
It's good.
Okay, I'll make a motion that we adjourn. Do you have a second?
Second.
Heidi, did you want to say anything, Heidi?
I have a question.
Before we adjourn?
Before you adjourn.
Officially?
I guess officially, yes. That would be what I'm looking for. I just came from the Conway Firemen's Auxiliary meeting.
The
Conway Firemen's Auxiliary meeting.
Okay.
And every year we use the town hall for the rag shag costume judging contest.
Yes, and it's a lot of fun, and the kids
and
really enjoy it.
It's a lot of fun, and the kids really enjoy it.
Mm-hmm.
Care to ask what's going on with the town hall and if we're going to be able to use it again this year before we put our announcement out about it.
And this would be the upstairs.
The upstairs. The big area to be able to have all the kids around.
All of the people who have their things up there would strenuously object.
Who are all the people?
The Historical Commission, Conservation Commission, Planning Board all have their materials up there. I'll try to find a way to...
Let's see, we can segregate.
To cordon off
those
areas. It might cost...
That stuff was all there last year.
Yeah, maybe? It sounds like it was there
and
same
I just
as last year.
The desk to the outer edges and we kept that away from everybody.
Well, they're pretty well edged, but I would like to make sure that they're not accessible.
Because that's a great event for the kids every
year. Oh.
So.
I have to get the article out tomorrow, unfortunately, so the sooner I can know, the better.
You want official approval?
I'll find,
I want to know that I definitely can have it there.
I'll find some way to cordon off the...
Tom will make it work.
All right.
Tom will make it work.
Okay. Tom will make it work. Got it.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Heidi.
Yep. Okay.
Have a good night. Okay, so now I'll make a motion to adjourn. If there's nothing else.
Say it.
Okay.
Aye.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.